First, we'll show Dr. Narasimha's slide, then Kavita, then Dr. Vishnu
Okay.
for introduction.
Yeah. Amit, you need to change the order, please. I have put Dr. Vishnu's first. I have made depending on the talk. Okay. Yeah, perfect. Yes. Okay.
We are live, ma'am.
Yes.
नमस्तुभ्यं वरदे कामरूपिणि विद्यारम्भं करिष्यामि सिद्धिर्भवतु मे सदा पद्मपत्रविशालाक्षि पद्मकेसरवर्णिनि नित्यं पद्मालयां देवी सामान् पातु सरस्वती भगवती
Dr. Nuri.
Yes, please. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the IACI webinar session on cardiac sarcoidosis summarized, multimodality comprehensive review by the team of experts. And I can tell you that whom we are going to listen today are really the team of experts without any exaggeration, and probably the ones who have literally made the cardiac sarcoidosis a diagnosis per se since the last two decades. So these are the two people, Dr. Narasimhan and Dr. Kavita. Extensive work which has been published, and probably if someone had pinpointed sarcoidosis cardiac involvement, that is these two people from this part of the country, and they have made a as a modality itself, the cardiac sarcoidosis. So I would like to introduce Dr. Narasimhan first, please. Can I have the presentation slide, Dr. Narasimhan? Dr. Narasimhan is an acclaimed electrophysiology expert in India and abroad. Presently, he is Arrhythmia and Electrophysiology Services Director at AAG Gachibowli. He's got vast experience teaching, awards, research, and I mean, you cannot ask for anything, any better CV than this. I know Dr. Narasimhan, sir, from his CMC Vellore days. Akhila was my colleague. And one great thing what we used to listen at that time was Dr. Narasimhan's lecture or bedside will always have at least 100 students there. So that is his capability as a teacher in CMC Vellore. And obviously, the whatever you see on the slide is nothing less than what is expected of Dr. Narasimhan. So welcome, sir, Dr. Narasimhan. Our audience will be enriched with your experience, clinical experience in sarcoidosis, and also the diagnostic issue of it. Welcome, sir. Welcome to the meeting,
thank
sir.
You. Thank you very much.
Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Kavita, who is the professor of nuclear medicine in NIMS Hyderabad. We have seen her last time also. Again, she is the one, along with Dr. Narasimhan, they have done pioneering work in cardiac sarcoidosis, first time in the country in 2005. And she is the one who designed this diet for sarcoid PET, diagnosing the sarcoidosis on PET. And together, both of them have got the largest experience in this part of the country, or probably in most of the world also, in cardiac sarcoidosis. Welcome, Kavita. We'll be very much happy to have you and learn a lot from your experience. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. Vishnu, our own Vishnu, who in the team of Dr. Narasimhan for a long time, who has finished DNB from CARE, and he has been associated with Dr. Narasimhan for a long time. And actually the entire cardiac sarcoidosis diagnosis, everything was started in CARE hospital, and they presented a lot of papers, and Vishnu also was in their team. And welcome, Vishnu, for your presentation on the case of cardiac sarcoidosis. And we look forward for a great academic feast from all of you. Over to Dr. Priya, please.
Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. So we begin with our first session by Dr. Vishnu on role of MRI in cardiac sarcoidosis. Dr. Vishnu.
Good evening, everyone. In my brief presentation, I will show you a few case examples of how a classic cardiac sarcoid can present on imaging, as well as one case of very early stage of sarcoidosis. So sarcoidosis is a multisystem disease with granulomatous inflammation as the hallmark. It can affect any organ in the body. The exact cause of the disease remains unknown still, but there is a popular theory of an immunologic response to an unknown antigenic trigger, which can lead to these granulomatous inflammation in the body. Cardiac involvement manifests clinically in only 5% of patients of systemic sarcoidosis. But when an autopsy studies have been done, it is estimated that the percentage of involvement of heart in these patients is at least 25%. So most of these patients might be asymptomatic. So that is the burden of the cardiac sarcoid in cases of systemic sarcoidosis. So coming to clinical manifestations of cardiac sarcoidosis, there are three principal manifestations. One being the patient can present with conduction disease like AV block. There is other scenario where the patients will come present with ventricular arrhythmias in the form of VTs. And then in chronic cases, in long-standing cases, they can present with heart failure. So how do you make a diagnosis of cardiac sarcoid? The pathognomic feature will be demonstrating non-caseating granulomas in the endomyocardial biopsy. But the problem of doing endomyocardial biopsy is that even if you use a advanced image guidance based endomyocardial biopsy using electron anatomical mapping or MRI, the yield of endomyocardial biopsy to show sarcoid granulomas is very less. So that's the reason endomyocardial biopsy is a less preferred route. And that is where the advanced imaging comes into role, where we can with certainty give a possible diagnosis of sarcoid and imaging. And if there are any inflammatory structures like enlarged lymph nodes, which are identified on these imaging modalities, those can be sampled to do a tentative diagnosis of cardiac sarcoid. So coming to the role of imaging, I will be talking about role of cardiac MRI. So cardiac MRI can be used as a good diagnostic as well as a prognosticating tool in cardiac sarcoid involvement because it is very good to identify sarcoid infiltration and scarring, which is the hallmark in cardiac sarcoid. So whenever the sarcoid granulomas are infiltrated into the myocardium, you can pick it up very well with the late gadolinium enhancement sequence. And similarly, as a residue of inflammation, if a scarring develops in the heart, even that scarring is picked up very well by late gadolinium enhancement. So traditionally, using conventional MRI techniques, it was a little difficult to identify areas of edema reliably on our conventional MRI techniques. But now with the introduction of newer parametric mapping techniques, even MRI is also, when used appropriately, can be a very good tool to identify even early cases of sarcoid. So this is the gist of the recommended cardiac MRI protocol, which is supposed to be used in evaluating a case of a suspected cardiac sarcoid. This is taken from this position paper published by European Society of Cardiology. It is free to access and you can go through. So basically you do a morphology and function imaging sequences to assess for the heart. Followed by that, you can do a edema sequences like STIR or bright blood T2 images to look for any areas of inflammation. And then you do a LGE sequence, which is nothing but late gadolinium enhancement sequence. So you can use a 2D or 3D method, or you can use inversion recovery or PSR sequences. These are all standard sequences which we use in our routine cardiac MRI images, scans. Apart from that, if your scanner has a capability of parametric imaging, you can use T2 mapping and T1 mapping sequences, which can sometimes help us to identify areas of abnormality with much more certainty than with the routine conventional sequences. I'll show you an example case so that you can believe how important they can be. So, So when a patient is sent for with a suspicion of cardiac sarcoid or any myocardial inflammation, based on the imaging findings, you can tell with certain surety that this patient might be a candidate of granulomatous myocarditis, or he might not be having granulomatous myocarditis. So to say that, we usually rely on our LGE enhancement patterns. So for example, if there is no LGE or late grad enhancement, or if there is any one small focus of enhancement, or if there is a pattern of enhancement which is suggestive of any other cardiomyopathy, the chances are very less. But whereas when you find multifocal late and GAD enhancement, which is typically very hyper intense, I mean, in the sense it will be very intense when compared to the other forms of myocarditis. And usually the distribution will be mostly basal or basal lateral wall. And sometimes it will be associated with the thinning of the myocardium. So all these features of thinning of the myocardium associated with intense mid-myocardial or epicardial surface LGE in multifocal distribution. These are the hallmark imaging patterns which are supporting a diagnosis of granulomatous myocarditis. One more caveat here is whenever you find along with these myocardial scar or myocardial enhancement, if you find enhancement of adjacent pericardium as well, that has a very high likelihood of being a cardiac sarcoid in a suspected case. So this is a spectrum of LGE findings on a typical patients with sarcoid. So most often, if the patient presents very early, the scan can be normal, or the MRI might not pick up the abnormality on our conventional sequences. Sometimes you can have a focal intense enhancing patches like this. And whenever the enhancement is multifocal, as shown in this picture, you can see basal septal epicardial surface scar, as well as mid-myocardial reaching into subendocardial scar. And you can see the inferior insertion point of interventricular septum, and then there is contiguous extension of the scar onto the RV wall. So this pattern is thought to be very pathognomic of sarcoid involvement. And then when you find a combination of thinned out wall with intense LG in a non-ischemic pattern, you can see the enhancement being mid-myocardial here, epicardial here, transmural here. So all this kind of appearance with thinning of the heart, thinning of the heart muscle, your possibility, the probability of the patient having cardiac sarcoid is very high. So this is a spectrum of findings which we typically encounter in a suspected case of sarcoid. So let me go to the first case. So this case is a 36-year-old male patient who had episodes of syncope. So echo was done as a part of the workup, which was unremarkable. Subsequently, Holter was done because of his syncopal attacks, and the Holter did show multiple heart blocks. So suspecting inflammation in the heart, a cardiac MRI was advised to evaluate the patient further. I think that my PowerPoint crashed. Let me restart the share. Yeah, now the slide should have come up.
Yes.
I'm sorry about that. I don't know why it suddenly crashed. So this is a short axis cine stack of the same patient. Here you can see, if you see the contractility of the heart, it looks fair. But if you see at the basal septum carefully, it is actually hypokinetic. It's not contracting as well as the rest of the LV walls. Right? So that was abnormal. There was abnormal hypokinesia of the basal septum in this patient. So this cine sequence is done to assess the function as well as the contractility of the myocardium. So subsequently, stir images are nothing but the edema sequences, which are done suppressing the blood pool as well as the fat to look for any myocardial edema. So the stir image is showing intense hyperintensity or increased signal intensity in the corresponding area of the septum, which was hypokinetic on cine sequences. You can see increased signal in the outer layer of the interventricular septum in the same area. But whereas the base other slices, the lateral wall was not very clear in this case because of the artifacts which we had during the study. But this abnormality was pretty evident. So following that, when we did the late GAD enhancement sequence, this is the phase sensitive inversion recovery sequence done after 15 minutes of administering the gadolinium contrast. Here you can see intense mid-myocardial scar. This is a bright scar. You can see the intensity. It usually matches that of an infarct. So typically in other cardiomyopathies, you don't see such intense enhancement. seeing such intense enhancement in the myocardium should always raise a suspicion of granulomatous inflammation. So this patient showed intense enhancement in the mid myocardium involving the septum. So the beauty of MRI was that we were also able to notice few enlarged lymph nodes in the prevascular space here. So subsequently, based on these findings, the patient was sent for PET. Because this was an index presentation, he never had symptoms before. So he was referred for a PET CT scan as well to quantify or evaluate the areas of inflammation, and as well as to pick up the right node for sampling for biopsy. So PET, you can see the PET representative PET images in the short axis view. These are the fused PET and CT images. So the area showing scarring on the MRI, which was in the interventricular septum, was showing some FDG uptake. But apart from that, it did show FDG uptake also in the lateral wall. So here you can see advantage of doing a PET here. This area of inflammation, which was not picked up on our stair sequence, is very beautifully demonstrated in the PET CT. So that is the problem with our conventional stair sequences. If they don't come out well, you will not be confident enough to call it as edema or not edema. So you, whichever areas you are confident, you can call it, but it doesn't mean that other areas are not without inflammation or edema. It is actually proven by this case. So PET also showed lightening up of these mediastinal nodes, and these nodes were targeted for sampling, and it did show non-casein granulomas on biopsy. So this was finally diagnosed as sarcoidosis, and the patient was started on immunosuppression because there are a lot of areas of inflammation shown as shown on PET CT. So that is the first case, index case. So this is a companion case. This is a slightly elder male, 64 years age, who had slow onset of breathlessness, and he had episodes of palpitations with syncopal attacks in the recent past. Echo was done as a part of evaluation, which showed reduced ejection fraction. Cath was done keeping his mind and keeping his age and as well as other risk factors into consideration, but coronaries were normal. So a cardiac MRI was requested to assess for the cause of the decreased function on echo. So just like the earlier case, right at in the short axis cine views, what we are seeing is, again, a basal septum, which is not contracting that well. And if you see, it is slightly thinned out as well compared to the other walls of the LV. One more interesting finding in this case was, you can see the inferior wall of the RV. It is actually dyskinetic. As the rest of the right ventricle is going into contraction, moving to inwards, we can see the inferior wall going outward. So this is the area of dyskinesia in the inferior wall of the RV. So these are the findings on cine sequences, and you can also see that global contractility is slightly reduced than the earlier case. So these are the delayed enhancement scans. Here you can see again intense enhancement. So the catchphrase here is intense enhancement. The intense enhancement is involving the mid myocardium of the septum. You can see the entire septum, almost from base till the mid septum, is showing intense enhancement, which is mid myocardial. You can also see epicardial surface enhancement, epicardial enhancement on the mid inferolateral wall. Also, you can see the contiguous extension of the enhancement from the insertion points of the interventricular septum onto the inferior wall of the right ventricle, which is again, as I said earlier, is a pathognomic of the sarcoid infiltration. And one more interesting finding in this patient was there was also intense pericardial inflammation going on. You can see this is the epicardial scar, and this is the intervening pericardial fat, which has been suppressed in this fat suppressed sequence. And beyond that layer of the fat is the intensely enhancing and thickened pericardium. So this patient also had pericardial inflammation, which is again known to occur in sarcoid. So same pathology seen on a four-chamber view. So you can see intensely enhancing pericardium as well as mid-myocardial scar in the septum and epicardial scar on the lateral wall. So this patient also had enlarged nodes, which are seen in the white blood images before contrast as well as post contrast. There were no areas of necrosis on this in this node. So this looked more like a chronic case. I don't have edema sequences with me because he had the associates were not very good. They had a lot of artifacts. That's why I'm not showing them. So subsequently, a PET CT was done. So interestingly, seeing so much scarring on MRI, we expected to see at least, if not the entire, at least half of the area showing intense FDG uptake. But this PET CT did show only mild FDG uptake in the septum as well as in the lateral wall. So you can see how if this patient was sent only for PET based on initial suspicion of sarcoid, we would all missed all the extents of scarring on the patient, which would have been very important for the management of the patient. So with so much extensive scar, he is ideal candidate for implanting a ICD to prevent any sudden cardiac event. So which modality should be chosen? So this is an example from one of the articles describing beautifully how FDG MR, FDG PET MR is our next future hope. Right now we don't have wide access to this one. So these are the FDG PET MR images. So you can see here how the cardiac sarcoid can be polymorphic. So you are seeing absolutely no enhancement in the septum here, but on a PET image, PET fused image, you are seeing intense FDG uptake there. Also, in the areas of scar, you can see the epicardial scar there. There is hardly any FDG uptake in that area. So you can have concomitantly areas of inflammation as well as areas of LGE corresponding to scarring or granulomatous infiltration. So ideally, a patient, whenever he comes for initial workup at least, he should have both the modalities done so that you can target the inflammation part as well as you can take preventive measures for the LGE, which corresponds to the scarring part. So that is the way we usually practice in case of this pathologist. So coming to the third case, so this is a 36 years old male patient who had actually lung sarcoid. He had a pulmonary sarcoidosis. So as a part of initial evaluation, a baseline MRI was done a year prior to the present scan, which I'm presenting, which was unremarkable. It was normal. So, but in the last 3 or 4 months, he had a few episodes of palpitations and he was a little worried about his condition. So to reassure him, we just planned to do a cardiac MRI because otherwise he didn't have any other holder abnormalities or anything. He just had episodes of palpitation, that's all. Even the holder did not show any significant abnormality. So a cardiac MR was done. These are the axial, short axis cine images. You can see the contractility is good. There is no focal thinning anywhere. It looks fine. But when we were evaluating stereo images, we could see bright spots in the pericardium, in the epicardial fat, in fact. You can see this is the fat supper sequence, and this is supposed to be area of the pericardial fat along the dark area here. So in line with that, we were seeing a focus of increased signal. So at the first look, we didn't give much thought to it. We thought maybe the suppression was incomplete. But when we did see the LGE sequence, that area was showing intense enhancement. The same area along the inferior lateral wall was showing intense enhancement in the epicardial fat. So this indicates that there is an involvement of epicardial fat in this patient with the sarcoid granulation. So he was then put on close watch following this scan. Luckily, his other areas did not show any inflammation. And since his symptoms were not very severe, EPET was also reserved for a later date. So that is how even the sarcoid can have lesions in the epicardium, epicardial fat as well, along with the myocardium, pericardium. Even the epicardium can show granulations. So that is the case of epicardial sarcoid granuloma. So as I told earlier, with newer techniques on MRI, we are able to identify edema much earlier than what we usually are used to. So this is such an example. This patient is again a known case of pulmonary sarcoid, which was proven on lymph nodal biopsy. She had absolutely no cardiac symptoms. She was planning to visit her daughter in US. And before going to US, her daughter recommended that she had a cardiac MRI before boarding a flight. So for that sole reason, though she was asymptomatic, we did a surveillance MR for this patient. So these are the still images. In the apical slices, there was some slight disturbance causing artifactual increased signal intensity. But this area in the mid-anterior septum was slightly of concern for us. It was showing slightly homogeneously increased signal. Here you can see it was heterogeneous in the apical segment, but whereas in this slice, it was homogeneous increased signal in this area. So when a T2 mapping was done, that area, exact area, which corresponds to segment 2 here, was showing very high T2 values. It was around 57 milliseconds, which is very high. You can see the pictorial diagram representation also. The values in this segment was very high. So this is an area of focal edema in case of a systemic sarcoidosis patient. So this patient might have early involvement of the myocardium in this case, but since the patient's symptoms were, she was actually asymptomatic. So we recommended her to get a frequent checkups from this point onwards so that we could pick up any abnormalities in her rhythm or any other minor symptoms could be picked up early. So that is how T2 parametric mapping can be useful if you have an access to that sequences to pick up early changes of edema in the myocardium more confidently than with the routine stir images. So one more application of MRI is you can follow up patients for resolution of LGE. Because not all LGE corresponds to scarring. It can be just pure granulomas as well. So this is such an example. This is a scan done at the initial presentation. You can see extensive areas of inflammation, which is consistent with granulomatous myocarditis. But on the subsequent follow-up MRI done recently, it showed resolution of LGE in the basal inferior wall. You can see it here. So, and there are residual areas, which is nothing but a scarred myocardium. So you can also follow up for any changes in the LGE pattern. If the patient is showing a new onset of symptoms, or if there is a reason to suspect there is some new changes which needs to be correlated with. So to summarize, if there is a patient of suspected sarcoid, you can choose either PET or cardiac MRI. So once a cardiac MRI is preferred because it gives us information about scarring, and if there is a scarring, you might want to intervene much quicker to prevent any sudden event. So if it is normal, this is the workflow which you can do. You can also do based on normal or abnormal MRI. If the suspicion is strong, you can go for a PET CT as well to look at inflammation of the myocardium so that immunosuppressive therapy can be started as well. So that is a brief gist of imaging algorithm. Thank you very much. That will be about MRI. If there are any questions, we'll be taking it at the end of the session, I think.
Dr. Vishnu, that was really a nice presentation. And I'm sure there are a lot of questions probably which we'll discuss in the end. So now we move to Dr. Kavita. She will explain about role of nuclear medicine in diagnosis of sarcoidosis. Ma'am, your audio. Yes. Now you can share the screen.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Priya, and thank you, Dr. Vijayabhaskar, for your kind introduction and then giving me opportunity to present our experience in this forum. Now, in the following few slides, we'll see how we helped this imaging in the diagnosis of cardiac sarcoid. So, first, let me introduce positron emission tomography to the people who are new. PET is nothing but a molecular imaging where we are using positron emitting isotopes, which are tagged with biological molecules like glucose. And then this is used for imaging. So here it is fluorine 18 tagged with glucose, which forms fluorodeoxyglucose. And then when this fluorine is a positron emitter, positron is nothing but positively charged electron. When it combines with electrons in the body, it produces two gamma rays at 180 degrees apart. When these gamma rays are detected by the detectors of PET scanner, then you will find the signal. And this is glucose. We are seeing the distribution of glucose in the entire body. As you all know, our brain is the highest utilizer of the glucose. So you see intense uptake in the brain. And wherever there is a lot of mitotic activity where there is a lot of demand for glucose and glycolytic pathways, then the tracer will go there. So that's the reason why it's the preferred investigation in oncology. And another important cell which takes up glucose is macrophage. So where there is a lot of, again, because of inflammation, a lot of glycolytic pathway going on. And then so the tracer will be concentrated in the macrophages and inflammatory cells. Though it was a deterrent in oncology, but it became boom in certain detection of certain inflammatory conditions, for example, cardiac sarcoid, and also in evaluation of patients with PUO, where we can diagnose vasculitis and infections and all. So this is a brief thing which shows how it's being taken up. It's like glucose analog by GLUT receptors along with glucose. This FDG goes inside the cell, and then there it enters into the metabolism of glucose, where it's acted upon by hexokinase and then further goes on. And then at this level of conversion into pyruvate, glucose goes ahead and then undergoes glycolysis. But this FDG, because of absence of the enzyme, which is responsible for further degradation of these products, it gets arrested. So it goes into the cell and then we'll get the signal from there. So FDG in inflammation, as I already told, because of increased expression of GLUT receptors in inflammatory cells, so you get increased uptake of FDG in inflammation. So this is the main basis for the use of FDG PET in cardiac sarcoidosis. So inflammatory cardiac sarcoidosis is one of the causes of inflammatory cardiomyopathies, of course, like viral cardiomyopathy and viral myocarditis or tuberculous myocarditis. All those can cause inflammatory cardiomyopathies, and where they have dilated the heart, and then they present with the ventricular tachycardia, left ventricular failure, and these inflammatory cardiomyopathies are treatable if diagnosed early, before they go into scarring. Unlike other inflammatory cardiomyopathies, like I said, viral, which will be diffuse, cardiac sarcoid is patchy. That's the reason why the yield from blind endomyocardial biopsy would be very low. Hence, imaging is preferred for the diagnosis, even for guiding interventions. So, earlier, it started with MR. It was the preferred modality in evaluation of cardiomyopathies because it can detect the other causes of cardiomyopathies, not only inflammatory. You can differentiate inflammatory from many other causes. So that's the advantage of MR. But there are some specific imaging modalities where inflammatory, they are specific and then sensitive, highly sensitive for inflammatory cardiomyopathies. Before FDG PET, this gallium citrate, which is used, this is like gamma camera imaging, gallium citrate, 67 gallium citrate scan, which used to be used earlier to FDG PET. But it's just two-dimensional imaging and then gallium, very low photon flux. So the image quality is not very good. So because of its limited spatial resolution and less sensitivity, it was very sparingly used, though it has a place, it had a place in diagnostic algorithm proposed by Japanese Society for Cardiac, cardiac sarcoid guidelines. Gallium citrate scan did find a place early on, but after we had PET CT, it was proven to be highly sensitive and preferred modality today. And of course, only modality in the presence of renal issues and then after this ICD placement, where many of these cardiomyopathy patients would be coming to the clinician after placement of ICD because they might present to the OPs as severe VTs and then failures and all. So in such cases, and also in chronic renal diseases where the contrast is contraindicated, so can't do MRI and PET is the only way. FDG PET is the only way we can help them out. And it's highly sensitive as it's a biological marker. Like these are all biological substances, molecular imaging. It gets deposited even when few cells are involved. So it's highly sensitive investigation, though not very specific for only sarcoid, as I said. So inflammatory myocarditis is a broad term where we use while reporting. And I just want to correct Dr. Vishnu at this level. He said diagnosis of scar is the strength of MRI. I don't think so because gadolinium enhancement will be there in scar tissue also. The same delayed contrast enhanced MRI will be used for cardiac viability, right? But whereas for us, that is the main strength of PET, I always tell in my presentations everywhere, because we do perfusion scan first, where if there is a scar, we will find a defect, perfusion defect, and there won't be any uptake of FDG in that. If we have a matched perfusion defect and there's no FDG uptake, that is for sure scar. In PET, there's no doubt about it, and it's very simple and then straightforward. But if there is a perfusion defect and when there is an uptake on FDG, that is inflammation. So that's very simple, and that's the strength of PET CT, I feel. Because please correct yourself, Dr. Vishnu. And this is the first case, all thanks to Dr. Narasimhan. We started early 2005, we started doing PET CTs in this part of the country, like in our country, almost first one in private sector. Very few months, we were still working on oncology indications. I get a call from Dr. Narasimhan asking for a cardiac PET to rule out cardiac sarcoidosis. I didn't have any words, but still, as my mentor always said, never say no to anyone. So I didn't say no to him. I said, okay, sir, we'll do. Please send the patient. Then immediately the next minute, I started Googling and I found some articles based on that. We did FDG PET on this gentleman. He's a husband of a gynecologist and daughter of a surgeon at Mayo Clinic. He collapses in front of a corporate hospital in Bangalore and then VT, and then they have placed ICD. They did coronary angio, found to be normal, and he was running around for the treatment, and he comes and sees Dr. Narasimhan where he suspected cardiac sarcoidosis. This is the perfusion scan. myocardial perfusion scan. So normally this is a short axis view, which should be like a donut. So here you are seeing a perfusion defect in the septum, inferior wall, apex, septum, and inferior wall. And this is a horizontal long axis. This is the anterior wall, inferior wall, and the apex. So here anterior wall is normally perfused, but entire inferior wall, you are not finding any uptake. And then here, this is a horizontal, this is a vertical long axis. Sorry, this is a horizontal long axis, and this is a lateral wall, and this septum, you are finding perfusion defect, less perfusion compared to this side. So this is in a patient with normal coronaries. So normally we should expect normal perfusion. Then we did FDG PET, that is with 12 hours fasting, and you see. So you see the septum, which was poorly perfused, a lot of FDG uptake. You are seeing nice inferior wall, which is hardly seen there. You can see this uptake and all, and also some uptake in the right ventricle. So this is the perfusion scan, and this is the FDG scan. So you can see nice mismatch. You can see the filling defect, which was seen here, is filled up. So if this filling defect persisted, even in the inferior wall, you can see the uptake nicely, FDG uptake. If this is persistent here, then we call it scar. And if, because there is uptake here in the area of hypoperfusion, why hypoperfusion? It's very simple, like it is nothing but vasculitis and then less perfused, so less uptake there on perfusion scan. And then this is inflammatory cells all going up there. So this is a mismatch, this is characteristic. Another advantage of PET is, see, in this chest imaging, nice, your characteristic hilar nodes, splenic deposit. The biopsy from these nodes, subcarinal nodes, proven to be inflammatory sarcoid. It's simple, straightforward, and diagnostic, see, nothing. And this patient is treated by Dr. Narasimha. So this is a paper which I found, which was published from Japan, where they have given us the protocol for ammonia they used for perfusion, but here we can use technetium tetraphosphamine, which is our system maybe which we use for regular stress myocardial perfusion scans. This ammonia is again PET agent. It can be done only with on-site cyclotron. So this is the protocol which they followed, and then just they advised overnight fasting. That started our journey in cardiac sarcoidosis, and almost every week we used to have 2 to 3 cases from Dr. Narasimha. I should say, as Vijay Bhaskar rightly said, we have the largest experience in the, I have traveled almost all the countries like where they do sarcoid, even Japan, Australia, and America. But the number of cases which we have seen are really enormous, and it's very unfortunate. Because of the volume of work and all those things, we could not publish the data, but we have enough experience on that. So the diagnostic is straightforward. So it's an absent perfusion and positive FDG mismatch. So it is suggestive of advanced disease, which have relatively poor prognosis, or high risk patient, I said. It's a poor prognostic indicator. If you find normal perfusion and positive FDG, that is the early diagnosis. And then absent perfusion, absent FDG, it is scar or nothing but fibrosis. These are the diagnostic features we see on FDG PET CT. So, but life is never a straight line. So we were doing fasting scans. We realized sometime entire like this myocardium picking up. So this is a whole body scan done in an oncology patient. So I was flabbergasted. What is this entire myocardium? Then again, I had to go back and then say, they say cardiomyocyte is omnivorous. It takes glucose, it takes fatty acids, everything. So then how do we rely on the uptake of FDG? All these patients, many of them will come overnight fasting for oncology also. So then we started looking. So we found all these types in these non-cardiac patients. So some have this entire uptake, some have this variable uptake, some have like this. So then we analyzed and then found almost 63% will have when there were simple fasting, you have 63% of patients having myocardial uptake. So how do we rely on that? So then a lot of search, a lot of consultation where Dr. Sharmila helped us from Boston, and she had shared the fat diet which they were following. This is followed for imaging of inflammatory plaques where you have to suppress the myocardium. So there they used to use very high fat, low carbohydrate, protein preferred diet. So here we are just taking off the glucose, making it non-available to the cardiomyocytes and giving lot of fat so that it takes only fat. It will never go for glucose. So that's the reason, even in fasting state, because of high insulin levels, so you get a lot of glucose available. So that's the reason why cardiomyocytes were picking up and we were getting false positives, like uptake when we wanted to do, when we wanted to find out inflammation. So there we found this very high fat, low carbohydrate, protein preferred diet. So this diet also is not simple, the diet which they sent from US, because there are majority of them are non-vegetarians and their food is totally different from our food, eating always dosa, vada, idli and all those things. So, and rice eaters, meat eaters. So we had to struggle a lot in preparing a very high fat diet for our people and especially the vegetarians. So then with this diet, then followed by perfusion, FDG, of course, perfusion, SPECT first, the same day we do FDG PET. We can't do PET first and then perfusion next because there are differences in energy levels. So perfusion scan should be done first, followed by FDG PET. And there is another addition from Japanese group where they were using heparin, intravenous heparin, in large doses, like 50 international units per kg body weight, where they say it'll be enhancing, it'll be, this heparin will be increasing the free fatty acids in the bloodstream. So the available fatty acid, fat availability will be increased along with these diet and then fat. So the combination of these three, the diet and then heparin and then fasting, many papers have come up now with very good quality. So this will yield us higher sensitivity in diagnosis, and not only the diagnosis, in guiding the interventions and also monitoring the treatment response. So we'll see some cases. This is the diet which we have borrowed from these places, and then finally we came up with these our diet, foods to be avoided and all. So this is a case where I can, this is a perfusion scan, the rest technician scan, a focal defect in the lateral wall. And then you can see this is FDG uptake. You can see the rest of the myocardium is being suppressed. And then you can see only uptake at the defect where we are finding. So this is the hallmark of the diagnosis. Next, this is FDG PET is a superior tool. This is an important paper which was published by Sharmila Dorbala and his and her team, which shows these. This is a normal scan where we find normal perfusion and then, of course, absent FDG uptake totally. And here you have normal perfusion, this decreased perfusion in the anterior wall and the septum. You are finding intense uptake there, and then the perfusion defect is very mild here because you can see there is very mild decrease, but there is intense uptake. Here, this is another case, again, the focal mismatch. This is the one which I said progressive disease and then high risk patients. And then here you can see there is no perfusion and then no uptake. This is a severe disease or scar or fibrous disease, which is irreversible. So this is from Dr. Sharmila's article. And this is, you can see, a case of dilated cardiomyopathy. There's no focal abnormality, no focal increase uptake. You can see this perfusion scan, of course, this is ammonia. When I was in Apollo, we had on-site cyclotron and we have this luxury of using ammonia, which gives very high quality images. So normal uptake in this thinned out myocardium, which is dilated cardiac chamber, but absolutely, this is not a scar. This is absence of inflammation. So this is a cardiomyopathy of some other cause, not inflammatory. That's low probability for inflammatory cardiomyopathy. So we are done with the diagnosis. Let's see how it helped in guiding the intervention. See this is focal mismatch. And then see this focal mismatch and see this lymph nodes. So nicely they can. So this is like this many cases we have helped in guiding the interventions. And they found that there are cases where they found mixed like inflammations, granulomatous and caseating and non-caseating granulomas also. So this is all these cases are from Dr. Narasimhan and nobody else. So this is early 2006, we presented in our Society of Nuclear Medicine India conference, where we had 116 patients which are referred for PET scan in 2006, almost 15 years back, I'm telling. So all these patients with clinical criteria, passing on through clinical criteria of cardiac sarcoid. And on this 88 patient had positive myocardial FDG uptake, where 34 patients had metabolically active lymphadenopathy. And we had 70 out of 88 patients had histopathological confirmation. And in these, 18 patients had both non-caseating and caseating granulomas with acid phosphobasalite. So these patients, this data is being published also. And only 3 out of these 116 patients had endomyocardial biopsies. I think soon after the introduction of PET CT, and then as we were giving very encouraging results to Dr. Narasimhan, I think he stopped and he discouraged use of this invasive endomyocardial biopsy. And then he went ahead with the FDG uptake and then lymph nodal localization and then targeted biopsies. So this is that was in 2006, we had so much of cases. So guiding the interventions, we are done. And let's see treatment monitoring, how treatment monitoring done in two ways in PET CT, where we can do it qualitative, seeing the disappearance of the defects of the uptake, and then the improvement of the perfusion, and also quantitative. There's something called standard uptake value, where we can measure the uptake of the FDG by the inflammation. So let's see how it helps. So this is a pre-treatment scan. You can see a dilated heart, and then this is a young pediatrician with ejection fraction of 27%, and you can see the nodes, mediastinal nodes picking up, and the biopsy proven to be cardiac sarcoid. And this is just in 3 months post-treatment. You can see the size also, the LVE is decreased, and then the size also is decreased, and you can see there's just a sub-centimeter node there, but absolutely no uptake. Absolutely everything gone. So this is by visual. And her ejection fraction was around 50. From 27%, it came up to 47 or 50% in just 3 months. So she was doing well. And this is another case. So you can see this is an ammonia scan. This is a perfusion scan. You find a perfusion defect in the anterior wall and in the septum. So here, this is the septum is fine, anterior wall at the apex. And you can see the FDG tends up easy uptake. Again, the mismatch. And here you can see in the lateral wall also, there's a perfusion defect and then intense FDG uptake. And this patient also had multiple mediastinal nodes, and then so totally gone, very little bit of myocardial uptake, but over time, so this entire nodes and all disappeared, and then cardiac coming back to normal will be little later than the nodes. So that's how it's so simple and easy. You don't need any major techniques, you don't need any contrast other than FDG, which we use for all, and it's absolutely safe. And you don't need any expertise. You can also see everything which picks up and then defect going away, which is filled in, and then some nodes which are bright, and then go ahead with biopsies. It's very simple. You don't need any Dr. Vishnu or Dr. Vijay Bhaskar or Dr. Priya to make the diagnosis. It's very simple. Only thing is the diet. We have to certain that once or twice with the patients what he had eaten. And we had one patient who had, he was very happy to have chicken for the whole day. And the next day he comes and then we were not happy in the uptake of the scan. So we asked him, what did he have? He said, I was eating only chicken from KFC. Chicken from KFC has a lot of corn starch over it. So a lot of carbohydrates. So the diet is not perfect there. So we need to include that also from them in the diet. So this is again another important. So this is again complete response where there is no uptake. So our protocol never goes without a perfusion scan. We always use perfusion and FDG. We never the case where Dr. Vishnu was referring, where uptake is there and the rest of the myocardium not showing uptake. I'm not sure whether they have done a perfusion scan or not. If they would have done perfusion scan, definitely they wouldn't have missed the scar. So this is and then qualitative. I'm very sorry that I have not much of experience on this quantitative analysis, because this SU is something which is dependent on many things. The uptake of FDG is dependent on many things, plasma glucose levels, and then the time of imaging, the dose we inject. When we are doing a follow-up scan, it should be at the same dose and your glucose level should be the same. And in oncology also, the weight, because the SUV always, when the calculation of SUV involves body weight, lean weight and all those things. So that also plays an important role in patient. If he loses weight in over 6 months or gains weight, again, the SUV. So it's not a very reliable quantitative parameter, but still roughly people have done many. There are few studies where they found it is very useful in treatment monitoring, where the SUV values you can find decreased in the patient after treatment, the SUV values here would decrease. So that's the reason why that's how they found it very useful in following, monitoring the treatment response in the middle of the therapy, like not at the end, in the middle of the therapy, to see how the patient is responding. If he's responding, they can continue, and if he's not responding, maybe they can add some other regimens or follow something else. So that's how the quantitative analysis comes up. So that's the only slide which I have borrowed from the literature. Rest all is from our hands-on experience. So coming to limitations and pitfalls, one is the diffuse FDG uptake, normal signs, and then normal perfusion. Then we are again clueless. Sometimes we have to depend not on the lymph node or the clinician's pretest probability to give as a myocardial cardiomyopathy, diffuse myocarditis or inflammatory cardiomyopathy. So that is one disadvantage. Another one, if you have only focal uptake, only in the basal lateral wall, this is again a false positive. If only with a normal perfusion and then a intense uptake only in one focus, that too in the basal lateral wall. So that is one focus which always bothers. And even then, even with that, if we find, so this is a case which we had recently, high clinical suspicion. We had only this, they did MR and they said positive for inflammatory cardiomyopathy, and they sent for PET. So this is the PET picture. Intense uptake in the mediastinal nodes, supraclavicular, mediastinal, multiple nodes, even the retroperitoneal. So a biopsy from supraclavicular node showed non-KCAT granules. So this is the strength. The strength here is the localization of other sites, thus guiding the intervention, making the clinician job easy in treating such patients. So So in nutshell, and the take-home points would be, it's a very safe investigation. There's no contraindication like renal parameters, any serum creatinine elevated, anything. There's no contraindication. A very simple, straightforward, and highly sensitive because it's a molecular imaging. It helps definitely in the diagnosis, guiding the intervention, monitoring the treatment response, though the qualitative things are again coming up and then needs a lot of studies strengthening that indication. And one and only choice in patients with chronic kidney disease and ICDs. As I said, the quantitative parameters in treatment response and prognostication need further evidence. As I told in the initial slides, the mismatch and match defect, both of them are indicators of poor prognosis or advanced disease. Apart from that, this SUV values they were using to prognosticate the disease. But this needs further evidence and a lot of studies. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kavita. That was really a wonderful talk. So now we have heard about role of MRI and nuclear medicine. We move on to Dr. Narasimhan. Sir, you'll throw some light about the...
Thank you, Dr. Priya, Dr. Vijay Bhaskar, and the Indian Association of Cardiac Imaging for the kind invitation. Like everything else, this also is a matter of serendipity that we stumbled on this entity. By an observation by one of our residents of a patient who had a severe LV dysfunction, was almost worked up for a transplant, cardiac transplant. And one of the lymph node in the neck was incidentally positive for tuberculosis. And following anti-tuberculosis therapy, this was several years ago, the patient's LV almost completely became normal. That set us thinking. Now, let me just lay the foundation. Why is it relevant, this entity? It's much more common than we think. All of you go back to your resident days or your house surgeon days. When a patient presents with a heart block, the treatment was a pacemaker. When the patient presents with ventricular tachycardia, it used to be amiodarone or an ICD. When a patient has severe heart failure and there's nothing else that medicines are working, they used to put an LVAD or transplant. But then we kind of stumbled on this disease entity, which has significant treatment implications. Early diagnosis significantly changes the trajectory of the disease in a patient. Whereas if you miss the diagnosis, as Vishnu and Dr. Kavita pointed out, you have a very scarred non-contractile myocardium, which is associated with significant morbidity and mortality. Ultimately, it's end-stage heart disease. The second reason why this is important and it's challenging is it's a disease of remission relapses. So just like multiple sclerosis or sarcoid, you may have a person whom you have treated very well. Couple of years later, he'll show up with a recurrent symptom or a recurrent VT or worsening heart failure. It doesn't mean that the heart is fibrosed. It can be a reactivation of the disease. And as of now, when we were treating these patients, we realized there's no consensus on management. Some of the treatment regimens which were initially prescribed by the Western countries were too toxic for our patients. They ended up with hip fractures or steroid-related complications. And then this diagnostic conundrum of tuberculosis in our population. Why is this relevant? In every population study, whenever you take a cohort of patients who have been adequately treated for tuberculosis and then follow them up for decades, there is an eightfold increase in diagnosis of sarcoidosis over the next two decades in tuberculosis. We'll come back to this. So this is a very elegant thing, which was again put up by a group from Olney Institute, Dr. Sharma. Wherever there is initially in 1920s and 30s, where tuberculosis was very prevalent in European countries, As the TB incidence came down, the sarcoid prevalence went up. So there seems to be some kind of an interaction between this and tuberculosis. Why is this important? Because we have all studied that whenever there is an antigen that comes in, our host immunity is so good, whether it's staphylococcus, streptococcus, you suffer a sore throat for 4 or 5 days, the bacteria is cleared, fever goes off, tonsils resolve, you become completely all right. That is a situation where the body is successful in containing the inflammation and getting rid of the bacteria or virus, whatever it is. But given a situation, there is a suppose a foreign body, a suture material, which cannot be completely eliminated by neutrophils or lymphocytes. What the body does is it tries to contain it by a couple of macrophages coming in and sealing and containing it within a granuloma, even though they are not able to completely eliminate this antigen. And that is how it works, a granuloma forms. This is way back in 2002, the index case that Dr. Kavita said, this was one case report which set us thinking. This is a boy who was presented from, I think, Guy's Hospital, London, 14-year-old boy who had recurrent monomorphic VT, and he underwent a successful catheter ablation, no VT, he was on antiarrhythmic therapy, everything all was well. And a couple of, I think, 10 or 11 months later, this boy died suddenly. And at autopsy, they found this tiny little granuloma. The extent of involvement was very minimal, but it was fatal because of the serious ventricular arrhythmia it resulted. People didn't realize that there was an ongoing inflammation. They tried to ablate this, and with a catastrophic result in this individual. Unfortunately, this diagnosis was made at autopsy. Nevertheless, it was an eye-opener for several of us. This is one of our patients who had a ventricular tachycardia, similar story. We thought it was idiopathic VT, ablated. And later on, we realized he had a small mediastinal node. You can see central necrosis caseation with the Langhans giant cells and a granuloma here confirming the diagnosis of tuberculosis. Now, why does a granuloma form? When our body attempts to completely eliminate the antigen, it's fine. But it realizes the antigen load is quite large. It doesn't have innate defenses. For example, large fungi, large foreign bodies, suture material, talc, an aggregation of macrophages that forms in response to chronic inflammation. They try to wall off this material and seal it in a given focal area. If it happens to be in the brain or in the heart, you're going to have serious consequences because of this granuloma. The granuloma may be small, but the location matters. To such of you who are interested, as was rightly presented, we are now understanding some of us have this genetic propensity for developing this kind of an exuberant granulomatous reaction. And that is determined by some of the HLA alleles and butyrophilin gene or annexin A11. These are some of the genotypes which makes an individual susceptible to develop this kind of exuberant granuloma. So when the antigen in any form, it can be, for example, an inhaled antigen in the lung, and that antigen is not eliminated, the antigen presenting cells recruits a lot of lymphocytes, macrophages, and forms a granuloma. At the end of this inflammation, if it's able to successfully contain this, the inflammation resolves, all is well, and the patient has a very favorable response. On the other hand, this triggers an incomplete resolution, which results in replacement fibrosis. That is what Vishnu showed as streaks of mid-myocardial gadolinium enhancement and areas of fibrosis, which results in ventricular tachycardia or AV block. So clinical presentation, how is it? How does it present? It's kind of our initial interest came from patients with monomorphic VT, where we have successfully ablated the VT and then they came back with a recurrence at a different site. That set us thinking to evaluate this disease entity. It was truly a godsend to have Dr. Kavita collaborating and immense help for us to help these patients. The index patient, which Dr. Kavita referred to, was seen in 2004 or 5, but the VT happened a couple of years earlier, about 5 years earlier, 2001 or 2, he had a VT. And they did a cardiac MRI and then did an EP study. It induced a VT. They diagnosed this as ARVC and put an ICD. But then there are certain atypical features, and we kept telling them this is probably sarcoid. But like every most of our Indian patients, they went to the US for second opinion, second, third opinion. All of them felt it was ARVC. Lo and behold, he came back after 4 years with declining LV function, worsening heart failure, recurrent VT, at which time, because the wife was a physician, she thought something was amiss, and then they sought a second opinion here. And Dr. Kavita's imaging helped immensely in confirming the diagnosis of sarcoid. He's still alive, doing well, EF is stable. We then described a form of varying morphologies of VT in a given individual is a signature sign of an ongoing inflammation in these patients. That is, for clinicians, it's called pleomorphic VT. When you see this, we err on the side of thinking of an ongoing inflammation rather than a scar-related VT. It can lead on to fatal ventricular fibrillation. We have now seen increasing number of patients who have been going on with this label as dilated cardiomyopathy. Approximately a third of these patients, 30% of them, have an inflammatory cardiomyopathy. One single question you ask this individual is there a family member with a muscle disease or cardiomyopathy? If there is a genetic cardiomyopathy, then your diagnostic approach is completely different. On the other hand, if you have a person who says no genetic causes in the family, then you need to work up for inflammatory cardiomyopathy. The other presentation we are seeing is when it heals, it leaves a lot of fibrosis and replacement of the muscle tissue. Sometimes it presents as idiopathic left ventricular aneurysm. ARVC-like phenotypes are known. We have a small group of patients who have been misdiagnosed as hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy who were referred for surgery for septal resection, and then they turned out to be cardiac sarcoid. And there is complete resolution of a basal septal thickness with the treatment of cardiac sarcoid. A very small proportion of patients we have had as valvular heart disease, both as free aortic regurgitation and free mitral regurgitation. The clinical importance of recognizing this entity is if you don't treat the underlying inflammation and just replace the valve, a couple of years later, they come with either wound dehiscence, valve dehiscence, or progressive aortitis, which leads on to serious problems. Had you diagnosed the ongoing inflammation and treated appropriately, you would have had a successful outcome. We have a small proportion of patients who have been misdiagnosed as coronary artery disease. I don't know about this disease entity. There are some reports in literature that there could be an arteritis in sarcoid, which can present as coronary artery disease. It's not atherosclerotic plaque, but medial inflammation of the media leading on to arteritis-like presentation. We have a small proportion of these patients who have undergone even a bypass surgery with a mistaken diagnosis of CAD. Now, I'm talking to people who are predominantly in the imaging area. To clarify what I mentioned, if you see a broad QRS rhythm where the beat to beat to beat, the QRS morphology is very similar, it's called monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. Whereas if you see two or three distinct morphologies, this is morphology number one, morphology number two, morphology number three. In the same strip, there are only two or three morphologies going on. Usually this is because of edema around that area. The functional circuit keeps changing, and therefore you have this subtle changes in morphology. This way, one of our fellows wrote it up as the first description. When a person has a normal heart, and they, when they come with this kind of a feature, you should suspect that it's an ongoing inflammation in the myocardium. This again is the original paper. This is very relevant for the audience, imaging audience. When a patient, suppose index patient number one, we do both PET and MRI. You see, MRI has absolutely no scar and PET has intense inflammation in the septum. With adequate treatment, this patient is going to do very well. You may have a complete resolution of the inflammation with even a no scar, residual scar left behind. On the other hand, this patient presents to you with a late diagnosis, extensive scar in multiple areas. Please do not waste time with immunosuppression. You need to think of a definitive therapy. You may have an occasional patient when both coexist. And those are the things where we give the benefit of doubt of treating the inflammation. So there is a complementary role of one along with the other, and we use this to our advantage while treating these patients. The index patient whom the first Dr. Vishnu started presenting with an AV block, the common thinking was when they present to a cardiologist, the cardiologist doesn't waste time, puts a pacemaker, successfully discharges the patient. Then we looked at why should a healthy young adult suddenly present with an AV block. Now, AV block, just like cataract, occurs because of extremes of age, and a very elderly person, calcific aorta, AV valves, and the calcification extends into the conduction system, you can have AV blocks. But why should a 30 or a 40-year-old person develop AV block? So we took unexplained AV block in middle-aged people between, I think, 20 to 50 or 20 to 60 age group. And we studied them, approximately 35 patients. 15 of these people had evidence of focal inflammation. Now, why is this relevant? In patients where there is no inflammation, just giving them a pacemaker is good enough. On the other hand, in patients who have ongoing inflammation, they have significant cardiac events during follow-up. This is one such patient who came with a syncope and a faint. She's about a 45-year-old lady and presented with unexplained AV block. We told the family that it's our protocol to investigate, but there were no guidelines and they referred these papers to the US. US doctors said, you don't need anything, get a pacemaker and get discharged. Then this patient, this was August of 12, and a year later comes with progressive decrease in LV dysfunction and then had a VT a year later. And then they spent a lot of money to upgrade the device to a CRTD, but despite whatever we did, the inflammation is extensive, the whole ventricle had become scarred over a period of time, multiple hospitalization. At this stage, they consented for a biopsy. When we made a diagnosis, it was a year late. And despite making a diagnosis, we couldn't do much because predominantly most of it was fibrosed myocardium, repeated hospitalization for heart failure, and this patient ultimately succumbed because of, I hope this works. I think I may join you. Anyway, let me finish. What is it? So this is another patient where the diagnosis was delayed. And then again, we lost the patient whenever the diagnosis was picked up very late. So the diagnostic clues are simple on electrocardiogram. When they have fascicular blocks or bundle branch blocks, please suspect underlying cardiac sarcoid, especially when a person comes to you for imaging and the patient comes just for a pulmonary sarcoid evaluation. It's important that you need to consider evaluating these patients for cardiac sarcoid if they have evidence of bundle branch block. I didn't realize that. So I'll just go on to this. This is one Dr. Kavita mentioned. We saw that in patients who are clinically doing well, uniformly the myocardial uptake came down, but patients who didn't respond very well clinically, worsening heart failure, the myocardial uptake increased over a period of time. And there we described a steroid resistance. Similarly, your MRI is extremely useful for us to plan catheter ablation to locate whether the scar is predominantly to the RV side or LV side so that we can get rid of the VT in those cases. This is one such patient where the presentation was as a mitral valve fibroma and severe MR. This patient was referred for MVR and actually it turned out to be a tuberculosis. The whole thing resolved with the treatment. MR resolved, his AV block resolved, and everything became better. This is one of the recent patients who has worked up for transplant, refractory advanced stage D heart failure, PAH, but because this patient was an SDA, there was some problem about the blood, accepting blood. And this patient said, I won't accept blood transfusion. And therefore they were seeking for a second opinion. And anyway, to cut the long story short, this turned out to be sarcoid. She's doing very well. PA pressure has come down to 35 and she is doing quite well. EF is around 40. So as I said earlier, if the electrocardiogram shows evidence of bundle branch blocks or fascicular blocks, you should consider cardiac sarcoid in these patients who present with unexplained AV block or ventricular tachycardia. So role of imaging, initial screen, especially in patients with pulmonary sarcoid, to decide on the site of biopsy, assess the stage of disease and prognosis, and whether to go for LVAD or transplant, assessing steroid resistance and planning on catheter ablation. This is our work looked at approximately about 90 odd patients. Whenever the patients present with severe LV dysfunction, but they have a good myocardial uptake, we don't refer them for transplant or LVAD. We intensively treat them very well. They find that these patients do very well on follow-up. On the other hand, if you diagnose a late stage of sarcoid and very little inflammatory burden is there, extensive fibrosis, you need to think of LVAD or transplant in these patients for with advanced heart failure. So I'm very grateful to be blessed with a lot of helpful colleagues in my department, as well as in pathology, Dr. Kavita, Dr. Zakir in nuclear medicine, and of course, Vishnu and Johan would help to with a lot of imaging, and Dr. Vijay from pathology department. So granulomatous myocarditis, it's prevalent, but under-recognized. Diagnosis is often delayed, and unexplained ventricular arrhythmias, AV block, with or without heart failure, may be the presenting manifestation. The biggest problem with clinicians is paucity of constitutional symptoms like fever, weight loss, and lack of awareness results in delayed diagnosis. Granulomatous myocarditis is a relatively common cause of unexplained AV block and ventricular arrhythmia, and it's a treatable cause of ventricular arrhythmia and a preventable form of cardiomyopathy. I'm sorry for this glitches in my presentation, but I think I'll get it sorted out. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. That was really insightful. I'll just invite Dr. Vimal, sir, and Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Noori for the discussion. Sir, there was a question in the audience that if there is a, is it possible that to have inflammation and scarring in the same patient, and can imaging help to differentiate both in the same sitting, and would the treatment will be different then?
I think so. This is one disease where one area of the muscle can be inflamed, the other area can be inflamed, healed and replaced by fibrosis. So the treatment, as long as there is inflammation, we continue with anti-inflammatory therapy or steroids in these patients.
Thank you very much for everyone. I think it was a fantastic compendium of cases, and it's really excellent, Dr. Kavita, Dr. Vishnu, Dr. Narasimhan, really adding a great value to the Indian Association of Cardiac Imaging. A couple of questions, just pulling on from what others had said. Perhaps I'll ask Dr. Kavita this first. Dr. Kavita, is there any differentiation based on what you see on PET imaging where you can turn around and say, this is more likely to be TB or this is more likely to be sarcoid? Is there any parameters which will help you in that?
we cannot differentiate. That's why I kept on saying it's inflammatory cardiomyopathy.
Yeah, Vishnu, what do you think? Is there anything that you may want to add on, something that will give you clues?
Imaging wise, no, sir. But only one thing is, if there are any caseating, I mean, matting of the nodes with necrosis in the nodes, especially not in the myocardium per se, maybe we can lean more towards tuberculosis. Based on pure heart imaging findings in the myocardium alone, it might be difficult to differentiate them both.
I think, I feel, you know, both MRI definitely brings in some added value in terms of looking at the pericardium, looking at the matting of those lymph nodes, which will help. But on the other hand, I think PET brings in a beautiful value because it will show the lymph nodes in the neck, perhaps, which are active, and then it becomes easy biopsy rather than going for the mediastinal lymph nodes that we have to target. So I think that becomes a very, very important point in here. Dr. Kavita, there was one question that was asked across in here. What's the difference between inflammatory protocol and perfusion protocol in FPG PET? Is it only the fasting instructions which are different?
Just one point to clear. FDG PET is to look at inflammation. Perfusion can be done on a PET scanner using ammonia, which doesn't need any preparation, or technetium on a gamma camera, which also doesn't need any preparation. Only FDG PET needs preparation. Perfusion doesn't need any preparation. Perfusion, majority of the times, done on a simple gamma camera where stress myocardial perfusion scan we do, no stress and rest. Here it is a rest myocardial perfusion scan to see the perfusion. No preparation for perfusion scan.
I think that KFC example that you put in, I think that's very important for everyone to remember, because we've had patients come in to us and they've said, you know, clinically suspected to be sarcoid, but they have an FDG PET report from outside which says it's all normal. So we send it to our nuclear medicine department and they say they did not follow any instructions at all. It was just a normal FDG PET, just like a cancer scan, and it's of no use. We will have to repeat it. So I think that is a very important point for everyone to realize in there. Dr. Narasimhan, one question to you, perhaps putting you in the spot, maybe. If a patient comes today and you are clinically suspecting there to be sarcoid, and if you're going to send for imaging, do you send for both? Do you send for MR first? Do you send for FDG? What's your protocol?
So if patient can afford both, he goes for both. But if he has limited finances, in fact, Kavita will know that most of them, we request Kavita not even to do perfusion, because I know I've done a coronary angiogram. I've done everything. I'm 100% sure there's no coronary ischemia. I just want whether there's inflammation or not. In fact, the first paper we sent, we had a lot of things because we didn't do a perfusion scan on a lot of patients. But we could convince the editors saying that it's because I've done all the other things in terms of ruling out ischemia. That was good enough. If there is one investigation, it's just perfusion imaging. FDG PET.
Okay.
Actually, I would add something here. So in my center where I used to get Simon's heart cases, though I was not charging for perfusion scan, because we used to always have some technetium which is used for coronary artery disease. So I never did only FDG PET. But I don't, the other centers, I don't know, but my data has all patients have perfusion cancer.
Dr. Nuri, any comments from your side, sir?
None, sir. That is perfect. So can either Narasimhan sir or Kavita, can you sum up for the younger audience what exactly is the protocol or flow to be done in such cases, just as a take-home message?
Sir, I have one question for Narasimhan, sir. Sir, can TB and sarcoid coexist?
So actually, this is a very important question that you asked. That entity is called tuberculosis sarcoid. That is, when you give, as you know, you can have exposure to tuberculosis in childhood, and there is reactivation of tuberculosis several years later. So when you give ATT to given patient, or if your macrophages have killed the MTB, the cell wall of the MTB still persists in the macrophages. In some of us, that creates a sarcoid reaction. So when you do a skin test, MANTU will be positive, IGRA will be positive, but that doesn't mean that it is tuberculosis. Unless you give these patients steroids, they won't respond. But having said that, in an endemic country, we dare not give, steroids without covering them with antituberculous therapy if their skin test is positive. So this entity is known as tuberculosis sarcoidosis.
So second corollary from that, this is for Dr. Kavita. Dr. Kavita, you know, is there a false positive and a false negative examples for sarcoid? What could be the reasons for a false positive or a false negative on PET?
False negative is obviously the preparation if it is not good. And when the patient is already on steroid therapy and they come for first time, then it will definitely decrease the uptake. And false positives, as I said, the basal lateral wall, if you see only one focus, nothing else, no lymph nodes, that could be false positive, then the clinician has to weigh on his clinical findings.
Yeah, I think this is an important parameter. That's a very good question that someone asked in there. False negative, definitely, as you said, when there is no inflammation and they're being treated for whatever reason, where it may have gone into scarring, where your perfusion imaging comes into picture, where it may be seen on perfusion, or the MRI will try and prove that in there. Follow-up, in terms of, I suspect Vishnu has answered this question in there. Vishnu, why follow-up with FDG PET? With radiation and all, would you not think MRI would be a better modality to follow up these patients?
Because we are treating inflammation giving steroids in most of these patients based on initial FDG PET. Subsequent PET will show us the extent of the response to the steroid, whether to modify the dosage of the steroid, whereas MRI will just say it's yes or no, which might not be the information which the cardiologist would like to know.
And do you think the STIR imaging or T2 mapping edema correlates with the FDG inflammation, or do you think you may not see them in MR, but they may be there on FDG PET?
We have seen a few examples where MR did not show edema on STIR sequence, but subsequent PET did show inflammation. As of now, I think the MR is limited by the artifacts which are mostly seen in STIR sequences. Maybe if a robust T2 mapping comes into clinical practice, maybe we can be more certain in calling yes, it is there or it's not there. Right now, what we are doing is a breath hold T2 mapping sequence, which can come very well in certain patients and which cannot come very well in certain patients. So it's a matter of not being able to do it robustly, and it's not reproducible right now with the sequences that we have at hand. Maybe okay. In the near future, we can reach there. Whereas the FDG PET is well established for that
SUV quantification, sir, had shown enough data.
Can I ask one question to Vimal and Rajesh, if he's around? Where are we heading in MRI? In identifying inflammation, if not as great as good as, but equal to PET CT. Are we heading there? Are there any chances? Or we have to always depend upon PET CT? Now I'm taking a fight there, turf battle.
I think this is one modality where I don't think the turf battle comes into picture, for the reason that there is both of these provide very good complementary information. And in most of the cases, we need to do both. As Dr. Kavita had said in initial point where she had said, if there is a contrast related issue, then FDG becomes a point. That I think MR will surmount that as a challenge with more T1 mapping and other things coming. Contrast may be something which we don't need to give. The thing which I feel, okay, let me just put it this way. Let's presume a patient comes in and there is a infiltrative inflammatory pathology which is suspected. I feel MRI has the added advantage of giving a lot of other information, which include the valvular function, the LV function accuracy, the RV function accuracy. It's a comprehensive test. And FDG specifically answers very, very important questions. So I don't think MR is anywhere in a position where it will be replacing it or it will turn around. It will be complementary when you talk about sarcoid. When you start about differential diagnosis, then it becomes a little difficult question. And I think MRI is good in helping in differentiating one from the other. And as somebody just put in the question and answers now, if you start thinking about Fabry's disease, et cetera, in there also, which can have some similar presentation, then it will help you in differentiating. So I don't think there's a turf battle, and I don't think we are going to be replacing FDG PET anytime soon in there. I'll just ask one question that they've been asking to Dr. Narasimhan multiple times. Dr. Isaac is asking you one question, which I think we know the answer, but he says, would you give steroids along with ATT in TB myocarditis?
Yes, sir, Dr. Isaac. We give a short course of steroids just for about 2 to 3 weeks and stop. The problem with the, it's the other way. If you flip it around, if a person has sarcoid and you give them, because their skin test is positive, you want to give prophylaxis with rifampicin, your steroid becomes ineffective. Rifampicin accelerates the metabolism of steroids. So patients, we have had VT storm getting aggravated once you introduce rifampicin to these patients. So we do use steroids in proven TB. And I think the TB, the problem is because it's possibacillary tuberculosis, microbiological proof is difficult to obtain in a vast majority of patients.
And Dr. Narasimhan, this was something which was asked. What's your experience in terms of how prevalent is TB myocarditis in the population that you see?
See, we have now approximately looking at somewhere around 250 patients where we have data, complete data on all of them. And mycobacterial culture for TB was in about 25 of this 250, about 10% definite TB. Possible TB in another 25%. So about 30% of this cohort have either pure mycobacterial tuberculosis or what is known as tuberculosis sarcoid. And the rest of them are.
And in this group, the ones which are proven TB, what we were saying earlier that they will have, most likely they'll have caseating lymph nodes or necrotic lymph nodes, there'll be matting of lymph nodes, there may be pericardial involvement. Was that something present or were these all purely TB myocarditis?
So initial cohort of about 20 patients in both groups, one of our fellows looked, we could not have any differentiating features except for caseation in the lymph nodes or if there is matting and caseation. We have seen non-caseating granuloma and tuberculosis and necrosis in sarcoid. So that's not an absolute truth. There are exceptions.
Excellent. I think this is very, very fantastic, Dr. Narasimhan. I think that's really, as they say, evidence-based medicine. And really, thank you very much for sharing your knowledge with us. It really makes life much more clearer for all of us. Dr. Nuri, I'll leave it to you, sir.
Just one more, I would like to add something here. And
yes,
one more place where PET CT would definitely be helpful. Today only I had a patient from Dr. Vijayabhaskar's clinic. That gentleman is afraid of getting into MRI tunnel, claustrophobia. So he referred that patient to me and he was there today and then had seen that PET CT machine and the bright ambience. And he said, this is fine. Will you do it now? Like that, he was asking. who was crying literally in Vijay Bhaskar's place. And his father was very happy to see him.
Dr. Kavita, I think he was happy to see you and he got scared of Dr. Nuri's beard, I think. That's what it is.
Sir, just one question. When patient presents with burnt out sarcoid, you know, very old, I mean, there are no mediastinal lymph nodes, but on MRI, we see multifocal LGE. You think of sarcoid patient as arrhythmias. Would you still refer for PET? I mean, even if it is that late stage?
Yes. The thing is, our traditional thing of sub-centimeter lymph nodes being non-diagnostic, we have been proven wrong, because if the lymph node is 7 millimeter and it's still FDG avid, we have picked up the diagnosis from those lymph nodes. But if PET shows there is no lymph node and you have a pattern in MRI, which is multiple scars like what you described, I seriously would question the diagnosis of sarcoidosis. There are other reasons why patients could have developed this kind of fibrosis. It doesn't have to be sarcoid.
We had a couple of cases, sir, where it's been reported as fibrosis, and then we have shown active inflammation in one or two minutes. So that is quite possible, and PET is very sensitive, as I said, molecular imaging. So picking up inflammation, it's very sensitive.
Because now these compounds called adalimumab and one of the biologicals are available, which are a lot more effective than steroids. We reserve them for patients who are considered to be steroid refractory. So we have a couple of patients who did not want to have a device because they are unmarried and other things. They started developing significant fibrosis, so-called LG on the MRI. And with adalimumab, the whole thing has resolved. So it makes a lot of difference in times of this kind of difficult therapeutic decisions.
Yes, sir, because even the active granulomas can show, can present as LG, not only the scarring part. So that's where this resolution on treatment comes in.
The fact that LG is not, if it is positive, it is not specific. If it is negative, it is not diagnosed. So LGE is now slowly fading away, and our T1, T2 maps are coming up. Right. So that is where I think LGE has been just putting to rest. We are putting to rest LGE, not depending much on it. So the story now, the bottom line is inflammation, if you are suspecting either with or without scarring, go for PET-CT only. That is the only answer. And MRI is not going to answer that. And that will depend, and that also tells us that treatment depends upon whether inflammation is there or not. This is probably the bottom line of today's presentation. Priya, do you think it's taking long time? Do you think we should thank Narasimhan profusely?
Yes,
thank
yes.
all the participants, and then we'll close
it.
Thank you very much. Thank you
very much, Dr. Narasimhan.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very
much, sir. I would like to hear you like this for hours together, Dr. Narasimhan. You are so clear. You are so lucid, so clear. I want to go back to my medicine days and attend the medicine classes with you, sir.
We will do that for the annual meeting then.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a pleasure having you, sir.
See you, Datu.
Our next session will be in August, on 20th August. And it is going to be on congenital heart disease. Dr. Dipali Saxena, who is also with an international experience, she will be sharing her cases. Thank you, attendees. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you all.
Yeah.